Your turn.
That was Michael Jackson, and I'm Whoopi Goldberg. And what you just saw was just 60 seconds of what is really a 17-minute miracle of a movie called Captain EO. Now, what other modern-day motion picture experience can you think of that's produced by George Lucas, directed by Francis Coppola, stars Michael Jackson, was made at the Walt Disney Studios, and is in 3D? Captain EO is that movie. History is being made with this very special film, which can only be seen in two theaters in the whole universe. One at Walt Disney World in Florida, and the other at Disneyland in California. Now, just in case you're wondering why I am sitting here telling you about this movie that I'm not in, to make a long story short, Michael Jackson and several other people were sitting around trying to figure out who was going to tell you about this. But since Michael couldn't do it and they couldn't do it, because, you know, Michael's working on the album, folks at Disney got Disneyland to work, they figured, well, let's hire someone who doesn't have that much to do. So Michael called me and said, Whoopi, look, how'd you like to do me a big favor? I said, what do you want? You know, I taught you how to dance. I taught you how to sing. What do you want? And he said to me, I need you to take folks on a special trip behind the scenes to show them just how Captain EO was made. So I said, okay. The story begins with the captain and his crew on board their spaceship as they journey to a faraway world. Now, after bungling his last mission, this is EO's only chance to redeem himself in the eyes of his boss, Commander Bog. EO is joined by his loyal, sometimes competent crew of oddball characters, like the two robots called Major and Minor Domo, the flying little furry fuzzball guy named Fuzzball, and the three-legged, two-headed, very grouchy thing called Geeks, and Hooter, the funniest and hungriest elephant to explode on the screen since Dumbo. Their mission is to use Captain EO's powers of music and light to overthrow the evil witch queen who rules her world with an iron fist. Or should we say, iron claws? Now, who thinks up these adventures in the first place? We'll meet the Imagineers, the guys at Disney who must have the best jobs in the world. They're actually paid to just sit around and come up with outrageous ideas. For Captain EO, they first had to create an adversary for Michael Jackson's character.
It just seemed that kind of a nightmare industrial world would be a good kind of environment for Michael to play against, because they're so completely at opposites to each other. So I started thinking about the way a world might look if industrialism and fascism and a lot of other unpleasant things had all somehow melded together into sort of an out-of-control, kind of a gray, awful society.
The next challenge was designing characters so vulnerable, so childlike, so playful, that inserting them into this obviously threatening environment would create instant visual tension.
Disney chairman Michael Eisner began assembling his creative team, starting with Michael Jackson.
You know, Michael Jackson is a Disney aficionado, knows more about Walt Disney than anybody that ever existed, certainly knows more than I do. And we called up and we said, Michael, would you like to do something with the parks? He said, definitely, but only if you can get George Lucas to protect me.
George Lucas is everybody's ideal producer. He's legendary for getting involved in every detail. In Captain EO, he was involved with everything from the creation of the characters to the planning of Captain EO's fight sequences.
Immediately sort of goes to the Queen, and she sends the Niche Warriors out, and then he transforms the Niche Warriors, and then the Queen, and then turns around and transforms all the troops.
Who could be more qualified to take Michael Jackson into outer space than the creator of Star Wars, with its special effects, eccentric robots, and strange alien creatures?
So then we got Michael Jackson and George Lucas, and they both said, well, we need a director that is without equal. And we went right to Francis Coppola.
While most people associate Francis Coppola with such dramatic epics as Apocalypse Now and The Godfather, Francis also loves music and has directed several musicals, like Finian's Rainbow, One from the Heart, and The Cotton Club. Well, Francis may love music, but no one ever said he could sing.
Old EO had some light. EO, EO, EO. With the light, he brought some color. EO, EO, EO.
Of course, singing and dancing is what Michael Jackson is all about. The whole world has been watching and listening to Michael for most of his life, as he's grown before our eyes from child star to superstar. With Michael Jackson, George Lucas, and Francis Coppola ready to make Captain EO, the creation of the sets for The Dark Planet began. There wasn't much time because of everyone's busy schedule, so the construction crew had to work really fast. Amazing, isn't it? You know, this is the way they'd like to see all movies made in Hollywood. Faster. Being the pros they are, the crew got it done with time to spare. So, with the sets built, filming began. We went behind the scenes on stage number 9, where the top secret production of Captain EO took place. Faster than you can say action, Captain EO finds himself in deep space and in deep trouble. In a fit of hunger, Hooter, the perky pachyderm, has accidentally eaten all the star maps, so the ship is hopelessly lost. While the crew searches for any signs of the dark planet, Captain EO is beginning to worry, because once again his reputation is on the line. The captain knows that he and the crew are always under the watchful eye of Commander Bogg, played by Dick Shawn.
Captain EO! Omar, cold cuts. Cold cuts in a spaceship. Looks like a pig pen. This is a spaceship, not a delicatessen.
You know the rule. No hot dogs in space.
Breaking the hot dog rule is the least of Captain EO's worries when they're attacked by enemy spaceships. The good news is that they must be in the neighborhood of the dark planet. The bad news is it's a lousy neighborhood. The captain and his crew are forced to fly through the treacherous trench city on the surface of the dark planet.
Going through!
No! I need a sales guardian!
Now everybody knows you can't really zoom off to other planets just yet, so make-believe spaceships have to be built. And in this case, Captain EO's 20-ton spaceship is really being tossed and turned by one Hollywood guy operating a hydraulic pump. Of course, even Hollywood magic has its limits, like when the multi-million dollar production was brought to a screeching halt because of a $100 hose, which sprang a leak on Captain EO's spaceship. Now, we saw what it looked like inside. This is what it looks like on the outside. Models like this are pretty much like the ones you can make yourself from a kit. These models are just sophisticated toys that are built by a bunch of grown-up sophisticated kids. Another great way to make a living, huh? Now look, we have a choice. Either we shrink down Michael Jackson and the crew to fit in here, or we film this model on a miniature landscape to make the spaceship look big. Of course, Francis chose the second option, which I don't know. I might have tried the first one just to be the first in history. So, anyway, the entire surface of the dog planet was built in miniature, and they called it Trench City. As you can see, even a miniature set is pretty big. This one was made up of thousands of pieces of metal and plastic all glued together. Michael got to see where the landing of EO's spaceship model would be filmed. The landing sequence is made up of three elements: a pilot's eye view of Trench City, the explosion of an enemy spaceship, and the crash landing on the surface of the dark planet. That's how it looked for the documentary cameras, and this is how it looks in the finished film. By sheer luck, Captain EO manages to crash land almost on target near the dark planet's homing beacon, but Commander Bog continues to be skeptical of our hero's ability to complete their mission.
Captain EO! Captain EO, where are you?
Commander Bog!
And we've reached the homing beacon, sir.
Well, so far, so good, Captain EO. Though I must admit, I am a bit surprised after the mess you made of your last mission. But now that you have found the beacon, take the map, find the Supreme Leader, and give her the gift. You do have the map, don't you?
No problem.
No problem.
Right here. Let it go.
Francis Coppola worked very hard to maintain the delicate balance between humor and suspense in Captain EO. Here, he rehearses the scene in which Captain EO and his crew have to set off on foot through the industrial wasteland to find the Witch Queen.
It's okay, the little group comes. Keep going.
Come on, Hooters.
Slow down, Michael.
You know, if you can find the humor in it, even though it's... Hey, come on, young guys, go. So that you don't, don't do that.
Okay? More quiet down.
Yeah, and more kind of longer. Come on, and laughing.
Okay.
At the
beginning. That's it? Okay. Stand by.
No! Shh! What are you doing? What are you doing? Buddha, be quiet. Buddha, quiet down.
I'm getting a disguise.
A disguise for what?
I need a disguise. I feel it.
Now, when your own crew is responsible for eating the map, wrecking the spaceship, and stranding you on a planet ruled by an evil queen, when you suddenly find yourself on the wrong end of 100 spears captured by the Witch Queen stormtroopers, you might just ask yourself, how on earth did I get stuck with this crew anyway? Well, Captain EO first met this outrageous crew on a soundstage in Hollywood, where you meet some of the strangest people. It was Francis Coppola's idea. He asked Michael to improvise job interviews with the actors who were going to play the crew. Veteran performer Tony Cox recalls how Coppola helped him develop the demanding role of Hooter, the most mischievous member of EO's crew.
It really got me into the character, because at that particular point, I didn't know how I wanted to play Hooter.
I strive for action.
It's just fun bringing it out, because he's somewhat like me. I don't eat as much as Hooter, but then again, who does? Hooter can play the keyboard. He loves to dance when he gets the chance. He loves to dance and show his stuff. And I remember the first day, it was very difficult, because I said, wow, you know, it's hot. And this costume was real hot. And I said, I don't think I'm going to make it, but anyway, I made it through it. And I'm glad I did, because I really was bringing out what I tried to bring out. For the first time, I went to Daly's, and I saw myself, and I go, wow, look at me. And everybody was laughing. I go, wow, this is great. Running in the costume, that's kind of difficult, because you got like 13 extra pounds on you. And, you know, I can't really see anything. I'm seeing, like, this way out, you know, and so it's very difficult. You just run and you just hope for the best. Hope that you don't trip over anything.
Cindy Sorensen and Debbie Carrington literally teamed up to portray the three-legged, two-headed geeks. Captain EO hired them because he was getting an extra crew person for nothing. And even in space, two heads are better than one.
I play one of the geeks, which is Idy.
And I play Odie, who is the crabby one of the bunch.
Yeah. I'm kind of the smarter one. I'm in control. Yes. And she's always lipping off and crabby.
The only time she's in control, when she's in the costume.
We're good compliments.
Yeah.
We're supposed to be one body, and being in that thing up to 3 or 4 hours,
Wait.
You start going a little nuts, and you're like, get me out of here. Not really claustrophobic, but just a little insane. I feel like a male geek.
I feel like a male Odie. Yeah.
I don't know why.
I don't either. Maybe it's the faces. I mean, we wouldn't look that ugly.
The next crewman to apply for a job with Captain EO was Major Domo, a reliable robot in the tradition of C-3PO and the Tin Woodsman. Gary DePue brought the mechanical man to life.
They actually had me move around like a robot, which I did, and found that once I got the costume on, that none of those moves could be done within inside this costume. This costume is only one way to move, and fortunately it looks like a robot when I move. I can, you know, move the arms, move the jaw when I talk, and when I open the jaw, the mustache drops down and it gives a little bit of character to it. And there's a man off camera operating my eyebrow with a radio controlled unit.
And that's how it happened at the Captain Joe's crew.
Well, that might be how Captain EO chose part of his crew, but the other two weren't big enough to have real people inside him. Meet Fuzzball. How you doing, Fuzz? Look him, isn't he cute? Now this little guy is EO's secret weapon. He's the captain's eyes, ears, and even his wings. But Fuzz has a secret too, don't you? Yes, yes, I love this guy. He's created by a very talented man named Tom Hester, who works with a man called Rick Baker. Now Rick is an Academy Award nominee, just like me. Excuse me. I'm sorry, did I know? I made a mistake. Pardon me. Rick is actually an Academy Award winner. Well, you know, I mean, you know, everybody has their days. I mean, you know what it's like. So, anyway, I promised Fuzz that I would show you some of his home movies. Look, Fuzz, that's you when you were just a little head. Oh, and look, your hair is growing in. Did that hurt? You know, there's a lot of guys in Hollywood who have that done. And look, your first dance lesson. Arthur Murray has nothing on you, honey. Oh, and there's Rick Baker. Looks like he's giving you your pre-flight checkup. And here's some of your other buddies. Oh, from American Werewolf in London. Did you see that, Fuzz? I loved it. And Greystoke. And look, honey, that could have been you. Hello. This is the last member of the crew. Major Domo's little brother, Minor Domo. Boy, you know, I hate to say this, I don't want you to take this wrong, but you do remind me of a vacuum cleaner I knew once, but I'm sorry, forgive me. As a matter of fact, one of Minor Domo's major chores on Captain EO's ship is to clean up after everyone, which is no easy task with someone like Hooter on board. Anyway, Minor Domo was built by Lance Anderson. Now that's him on the left. Lance and his staff also created Major Domo, Hooter, and the Geeks. I guess that means that you're all related, huh? There you are, just a shell of who you are today. And look at you before you were who you were when you weren't who you are now. Is it true Lance Anderson pulled some strings to get you this job? So, these guys got the job with Captain EO. I mean, tell me, how did he convince you to go on this mission to this other planet, this dark planet? No. Get out of here. I can't even tell you what he's saying to me, but... what I can tell you is that they offered him an incredible weekly salary, much more than they're paying me to do this, and a membership in the Creatures and Robots Union. I figured that would be an incentive for me, too. Anyway, when we last saw you guys, you were being hauled off by the stormtroopers to see the Supreme Leader, I guess that's one way to get an audience with the Queen. You really didn't need that old map after all, did you?
Hey, I told you I'd find her!
Titan! Infidel!
Infidel?
You infect my world with your presence! Destroy it!
In case you don't recognize her, the Witch Queen is played by another Academy Award winner, Angelica Houston.
I'll overlap you on so we both admit to your stupidity. Okay. Want to go again? Come here on it.
Well, if she said, why have you come, then don't I say to bring a gift then?
All right, you're right.
Tom and Barry Berman created the extensive makeup required to turn Angelica Houston into the Witch Queen. It took 3 hours every morning to apply the makeup. The rest of the morning was spent just getting her into the elaborate costume and then hoisting her on cables into her web of darkness.
Oops. Hard to get a girl's nails through mesh.
They told me that I'd be suspended. They didn't go into details of the harness or anything. Frances said she would be more of a spider woman than a witch.
She's referred to in the script as different things. Sometimes she's the witch, sometimes she's the supreme leader. Sometimes she's witch queen, the woman with a planet of her own. But always evil.
To bring a gift, Your Highness, to someone as beautiful as you. You think me beautiful?
Very beautiful within, Your Highness, but without a key to unlock it. And that is my gift to you.
So, let me see this gift.
Not only see, Your Highness, but hear.
Now the magic begins. Amazingly, this motley crew really has some talent. They may eat hot dogs in space, but when things get tough, they can lay down a mean beat. And music is the key to Captain EO's power. That's a unique way of getting out of a jam. And that transformation of the warriors into EO's allies required some inventiveness too. They turn off the camera and the dancers in black are now replaced by dancers in orange. Then the scene is shot again. Later, the Disney animators join those jazzy optical effects and lay them over the dancers frame by frame. And when it's all put together, this is what it looks like. Captain EO, boy, this guy is really something. I mean, he is about power, but the right kind of power. I mean, he can... Well, you saw what he did. I mean, of course, in the studio, through the magic of special effects, you can be anybody you want. I mean, well, yeah. You know, special effects people have a very warped sense of humor. This is not exactly what I had in mind, but don't know. Dolly's look is... I don't know. What do you think? Is it me? I don't know. Come on, guys. Let's try something different. A little more subtle, okay? Well, this is a little bit better. I mean, no one ever accused Tina Turner of being subtle. I mean, but gee, this wind ever blow through his hair? I mean, come on, fellas, surprise me, okay? Turn me into someone I can really get into. Come on, guys. You think Rambo is more subtle than Tina Turner? Okay, okay, look. I think we've had enough fun making Whoopi, okay? Let's make Whoopi normal again, okay? Special effects aside, dancers can't just randomly snap. They have to be choreographed. And the choreographers were Michael Jackson and Jeffrey Hornaday. They worked closely with Lucas and Coppola in creating a dance sequence with tremendous power. Hornaday's career has included a broad range of work, from the solo dance routines of Flashdance to the unified group choreography featured in A Chorus Line. The fantasy of A Chorus Line became reality at the open auditions for Captain EO's backup dancers. Now, the chance to work with Jeffrey Hornaday and Michael Jackson drew over 400 hopefuls. And for the 36 dancers who were chosen, the real work began at rehearsals. Assistant choreographer Helene Phillips was responsible for taking the dancers through the basic routine.
And stop, stop, five, six, push, eight.
When you hit here, don't do it this way. Make sure it's reaching out that side.
One, two, three, and four, six, eight, six, and eight, and two, and four, six, and two, three, four.
In a short time before filming began, Hornaday molded the 36 dancers into a cohesive unit, ready to back up Michael Jackson.
Working with Michael has, for me, been a unique experience in that usually a choreographer will devise sequences of dance and then give it to the dancers to do and tell them to perform this, where Michael's talent and approach is so unique that you're limiting yourself by just giving him what you do.
Once Hornaday got the feeling for what Michael wanted to do, he began working with different groups of dancers who were to perform key sequences. Here we can see how the mechanical movements of breakdancing were adopted for the transformed Niche Warriors. In another studio, Tony Award-winning set and costume designer John Napier is doing his best to create costumes that reflect the evil nature of the Dark Planet, but which also allow for the flexibility of movement necessary for the complex dance routines. John Napier is best known for his work on several major theatrical productions. Designing the costumes for the dancers in the 3D film, however, presented him with a different kind of challenge.
What I'm doing with the costumes is, you know, is trying to make people able to move in those scenes. They won't fall apart. In these kind of robotic characters, I'm just putting a lot of detail in because that'll work very well in 3D. And they have long, snake-like arms that are in fact whips. If you actually throw that whip out towards the audience, it's quite alarming.
Bum, 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 music, it makes it scary.
Makeup for the 36 dancers was all that remained to be done before Coppola filmed the climactic dance sequence, the heart of the EO movie. Weeks of planning and rehearsal would culminate in this important dance number featuring Michael Jackson and all the dancers. Now, only a few minutes remain before the dancers are called onto the set.
There you go.
And with all this pressure and the show about to go on, what do these dancers think about?
Dinner.
Now, when they're coming at them this way before the zap...
Adjustments are feverishly made until the very last minute. It's never really finished. You just run out of time.
Yeah. Here we go.
Just when you thought the world was safe for rock and roll, the Witch Queen unleashes her most ferocious fighters, the Niche Warriors. And because they're using real whips, the Niche Warriors are almost more dangerous off-screen than on.
Boom, the other guy over Michael's head.
For the fight between Captain EO and the Niche Warriors, Michael will have to make a series of quick movements with the whip cracking only inches from his face. So more than simple choreography is needed. Even a small mistake could have very serious consequences.
Throwing fast, he almost got killed by the gate.
Sure.
Great. Michael insured.
In this instance, choreography becomes more like precision stunt coordination, with the safety of Michael and the dancers having priority.
Who knows why a whip cracks? Because it goes so fast, it breaks the sound barrier.
Is that true?
But in spite of all the precautions, Michael had a very close call.
It's okay now.
The scene continued to be a problem. First, one of the warriors' helmets fell off. The costume department got the helmet fixed, and then the whip broke. The prop department got the whip fixed, only to have it get tangled up in the set. Finally, all the problems were solved. Sort of. Captain EO has run out of tricks. Well, you know Francis and George wouldn't leave him hanging like this. Trust me, I won't tell you how, but EO does get out of it.
Oh.
Michael's solo was shot a second time in front of a blue screen. This blue screen will allow different backgrounds to be placed behind Michael. And we decided to let him dance in a few places even he's never been before. Confrontation with the Witch Queen herself took considerable time and expertise to achieve. Here, Michael is being raised up on a crane so Io can fight the Witch Queen face to face. In order to shoot a different angle of Io flying up to the Queen, Michael found himself immersed in plaster so a perfectly contoured and therefore invisible body harness could be created for him.
Michael, can you put your arm forward and kind of high? As high as you can. Can you think you could hold that for a while?
Okay.
I mean, if we're doing a shot, could you, is that comfortable enough to?
Uh-huh.
How does the rig itself feel?
It's comfortable.
Michael looks real comfortable, doesn't he?
Hey, Michael.
I don't think I'd want to try something like that. But I have to admit, it looks realistic in the finished movie because you can't see the crane, you can't see the cables, and you can't see the harness. And it does appear that Captain EO is flying. So, Captain EO really did change the world. Miraculously turning the dark planet into a place filled with beauty and light. And on top of everything, the whole movie is in 3D. Now wait till you see that.
But of course, you still have to wear these special glasses. And now they make them kind of attractive. What do you think? A real Paris fashion statement.
You may remember reading about the 3D rage that began in the 50s. Everybody was talking about it. You may have even seen some 3D films, but never, until now, have you ever experienced anything like Captain EO.
You know, 3D is kind of tough to explain when you're stuck in here in two dimensions like I am. Right now, I'm on your TV screen, but look around you. I mean, real life is in 3D. Your kids are in 3D, and so are your parents. At least they're supposed to be. Now, the idea of 3D film is that whatever is happening here on the screen is supposed to look like it's happening right there in your living room. So let's take a look at the equipment necessary to make a 3D film.
The camera for this revolutionary process is really two cameras in one. It has two lenses, two loads of film, and shoots two slightly different images. The same way that your left and right eye see two slightly different images. And when those images are projected together, your brain is fooled into believing it's seeing depth on a flat screen. Of course, all the technology in the world can't actually shoot the picture. So one of the great European masters of cinematography, Vittorio Storaro, another Oscar award winner, by the way, was invited here from Italy to capture the 3D magic of Captain EO on celluloid.
No doubt that the great elements of 3D is the fact that really you can move in perspective, in the third dimension. If you have one dimension in horizontal, one dimension is vertical, the third dimension is the perspective. So with this production specifically, which is really mainly about energy, as more we can use the perspective in movement, the better.
Lighting is essential to all filmmaking. But for 3D, it's extremely important, and much more of it has to be used. The lights on the Captain EO set do enough power to light two city blocks or all of Main Street at Disneyland. Captain EO's new home at Disneyland used to be an outdoor theater by day, and by night, a showcase for Disney's first 3D film, The Magic Journey. But for Captain EO, a new specially equipped theater has been built with lasers, smoke effects, miles of fiber optics, and a state-of-the-art digital sound system. And to Michael Jackson, nothing is more important than the sound. He takes an active role in the studio to make sure his songs are recorded precisely as he wants them to be heard. Michael has composed two new songs especially for Captain EO. The first he's written since the Thriller album and We Are the World. The new songs are called Another Part of Me and We Are Here to Change the World. To achieve the vocal crescendo for the chorus of We Are Here to Change the World, Michael brought in a number of backup singers so that layer upon layer of sound could be added to his vocal tracks. In the studio, the music has been wrapped up, completing the long list of production chores. On the set, the story of Captain EO is drawing to a close. The beautiful queen gratefully knights the captain, and EO and his crew leave the planet to seek new worlds to conquer with their very special powers of music, light, and love. Well, Captain EO and his crew turned out to be heroes after all, and they are once again respected galactic adventurers. By the way, rumor has it Commander Bog is now selling hot dogs somewhere in the far regions of outer space. Captain EO's next stop was back on Earth, where a big party was planned for the premiere of his long-awaited film. So here I am at Disneyland. There's hundreds of stars and celebrities. They all turned out to see the premiere of Captain EO. I saw Donald and Mickey Mouse came up. I'd say, isn't Mick looking great? 50 years, you look fabulous, Don. Who does your face? Mick, look at all the people who turned up for the premiere. All the Disney characters are here mingling with the stars, like Gene Simmons from the rock group Kiss. And the press is out in force, too. Gene Anthony, Ray of Fame, mega producer David Walper, and O.J. Simpson. What a day. Disney knows how to throw a party. Oh, Mick, look. Here comes part of EO's crew. Wow. And of course, you know, Michael Eisner, chairman of the Disney company, was there. And Jeffrey Katzenberg, chairman of Disney Studios, was there, too. And George Lucas, Francis Coppola, and Angelica Houston had the honor of cutting the ribbon and formally opening the theater.
So, I don't know, Mick. I mean, everybody's going in. What do you say? You want to give it a shot there? I'll give you your 3D glasses. God, you are looking really good at 50. I tell you, you know, I've always wanted to talk to you about your tail. Excuse us. Here, watch out for that pole. You know what happens when you get too big. I mean, there's some tales from the dark side. I mean, I don't know. Is it real?
These crowds are sure real. But everyone did get into the theater to enjoy the thrilling 3D adventure of Captain EO.
Incredible. Must be seen.
Absolutely wonderful. I must say, it lived up to all the expectations.
I love the music, and I've never seen a 3D movie before, so that was great.
It was spectacular. It was fabulous.
I tell you, right now it's very easy for me to be depressed. I mean, it's over. My job hosting the special is done. I mean, I still wish I got to be in it. I mean, I am an Academy Award nominee. I didn't win, but I was nominated. But, you know, I have to admit that I made some good friends on Captain EO, especially, you know, some real nice contacts. So don't be too free with the following information, but the gang and I are presently talking about getting me on board for the next space adventure. I mean, we're going to do a little lunch, a little negotiating, see what flies, you know. So I guess I can't be too sad, because I know these guys are going to be around for a while. But don't you wait for the next voyage. I mean, the captain's here, and the time is now, and I'm telling you, Disneyland in California and Walt Disney World in Florida are the places to be, because they're the only two places that the captain's at. So get on that plane, jump in that four-wheel drive, walk on that water, or get there any way you can. I mean, you know, if you just keep believing in the magic, I mean, maybe we really can change the world. No promises, but maybe we can. So, you know, hang loose. I'll see you again, and thanks, Michael. It's been real. I'm not dancing off because that's not my forte. Jackson dances, Goldberg swings.